It's time to slam now. We got the real jam going down. Welcome to the Space Jam. Here's your chance. Do your dance at the Space Jam. All right.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to another episode of Tripped Up Trivia. Here we are again with three new contestants and one repeat. That's right.
Well, Jesse, there's a certain little movie coming out. Actually, this is coming out the weekend that this will air.
Classic.
Welcome to the Space Jam.
I'm going old school on his butt.
Whoa.
Welcome to the Space Jam.
And whether or not you're a fan of the original Space Jam or even really a fan of basketball in general, there is no denying that we all love the cartoons that we're going to see featured in that film. We love Bugs Bunny. We love Daffy Duck. We love seeing all these classic characters. So tonight's trivia theme is Warner Brothers Animation.
Oh, wow. This is going to be interesting. So you got all your questions ready to rock and roll. And so I guess it's time to meet the contestants. So I guess first up, the W2M chairman returning to Tripped Up Trivia, Jason Teasley.
Yes, I'm ready. And I promise not to almost die this time.
We'd appreciate that.
Jason was one of our first contestants in May's trivia game, Sci-Fi Trivia, and he was recovering from what we affectionately named that night the Backstreet Boys reunion tour, and basically managed to stay with us until a fever and nausea basically compelled him to say, I'm out.
Yeah, he noped out real quick there after he almost died. Yeah. Come on and slam. Welcome to the jam. Mark Radulich is here, the patriarch of the Radulich and Broadcasting Network. Are you ready to talk some Warner Brothers Animation, Mark Radulich?
Yes, I am. You know, you guys started this trivia thing a couple of months ago, and I was like, do whatever you want. I want no part of it. This can only end in tears. But hey, man, I'm sitting out a UFC pay-per-view tonight for this, so you have my full and undivided attention.
You gave up violence to join us tonight? And
yeah, I gave up the third meeting of Conor McGregor and Dustin Poirier for this.
Oh, wow. All right. Well, you're the patriarch of the Radulich and Broadcasting Network, okay? But the patriarch of the patriarch is here, which is amazing. Chris Radulich is back on the Radulich and Broadcasting Network. How you doing, Chris? Are you ready to talk some WB animation?
Yes, I am, though. I suspect my score is going to be on the low side here. Not unfair, because my kid is 46, Mark?
40. I'm 45, father of mine.
45. So we haven't watched a lot of Warner Brothers in a long time, but he's got youngsters, so he's got an advantage.
Well, you're already whining about the advantages I have. Great. This is going to be a long show.
Uh-huh.
Well, okay. You know, anytime I talk animation with Mark, Chris's name comes up. So he always invokes the name of his dad and when they used to watch cartoons together. So that happened a lot, right?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
I enjoyed cartoons. I stopped reading comics, I think, though, in the 80s.
Oh, I've heard that story, too. That's a story for another day.
Yeah, Chris, you actually have been on the show to discuss cartoons before. Not too long ago, we did a coverage of when DC met Hanna-Barbera, and you were the judge, as we all talked about what our favorite stories were from that collection.
Yes.
It's a lot of fun.
I remember that.
Well, hailing from Iowa, first time on Tripped Up Trivia. It is Griffin Length. So are you ready to talk some WB animation?
Yep.
Just to make sure that we're clarifying, when we're talking Warner Brothers animation, I know some people think that that also includes the DC animation, Batman the Animated Series, Superman, Teen Titans, and the like. However, we actually want to do a comic adaptation trivia game here in the near future. So we're going to save all those questions for that. So tonight, it's purely Warner Brothers and Hanna-Barbera classic. We got Looney Tunes, you got your classic Hanna-Barbera characters. We're looking at the modern-day Warner Brothers cartoons like Animaniacs and Tiny Toons and such. All right, contestants, are you ready?
Yes.
Yeah.
I only heard two, but I'm going to assume
I'm alive.
I'm alive.
Present.
Okay, so yes, we're going to do 15 questions. These are 1 point each, and I would classify them as relatively easy. The 15 after that are going to be 2 points each, and they're going to be just a little bit tougher. Question number one. Known for his dizzy demeanor and apparently bottomless stomach, what character is actually based on a quadruped of the southern hemisphere?
I'm going to go with this.
Come on and slam.
Are you going to put Spock's mom again?
No. That's not my go-to. That's what I got cheated on.
All right. All answers are in. He didn't put Scott Bakula again, Jason?
I'm
saving that. That's my go-to answer. Way to ruin the moment.
We'll pretend it was never said.
Edit that out. The answer is the Tasmanian Devil.
Oh, rats.
And yes. Griffin, you're the only one who got that right.
Okay.
Good job.
My pick was the same color as the Tasmanian Devil. Do I get partial credit?
Oh, my gosh. It's starting already.
No.
I didn't know what quadruped was. Don't use big words.
Mark put Yogi Bear and Jason put Scooby.
I assumed Yogi was from Brazil. Can I apply right. my answer to a future question? At least one of these has to be Yogi Bear, right?
maybe.
One of these answers is Scott Bakula.
I cannot wait till that actually is an answer.
All right. Question number two. Which character from Tiny Toons landed their own spin-off series in 1992, lasting only 13 episodes? Now, this is a multiple choice. Was it Buster Bunny, Hampton J. Pig, Elmira Duff, or Plucky Duck?
So here's at the Acres, it's a whole wide world apart. Our home sweet home stands alone, a cartoon work of art.
Let's rip, we're rejected, expect the unexpected.
The answer is Plucky Duck.
We're not counting Pinky the Brain and Elmira?
Pinky, Elmira, and the Brain did not come out in 1992.
Plucky was actually my second choice.
Yeah, Pinky, Elmira, and the Brain came out in 1998. So that was the trick.
Oh, you wanted a specific year. Okay.
Well, I said it came out in 1992.
I wasn't listening to that part of the question.
And she gave four options.
All right.
Apparently, none of them was what I put on there.
What, did you put Huckleberry Hound again?
No, I put Elmira the Duck. Apparently, I missed something in there.
Well, the only person who actually got the full point is Jason. Question number three. What breed of dog is Scooby-Doo?
Ooh.
Oh, this one's easy.
Okay, all answers are in. He's a Great Dane.
That was close.
Mark, you wrote German Shepherd.
I picked a breed of dog. I was close.
Zero for Mark.
Dog anyway, I wouldn't say close.
Well, it's not like I said, you know, like Schnauzer or, you know, Westie.
Wasn't Mark, like he created a dog.
I didn't say it was a corgi. I was close. I think a German Shepherd is close to Great Dane.
Mark, no. That's why I was waiting for you to write cat.
It would have been just as close.
Shut up, Dad. I know where you live.
Griffin, Jason, and Chris all got points on that one.
All right.
Question number four. In the 1958 short, Hair Way to the Star, what reason does Marvin the Martian give for wanting to blow up the Earth?
You make me very angry. Very angry. Special delivery from Mars. Oh, goody. Another uranium peel 36 explosive space modulator. Isn't that wonderful? Now we can blow up the Earth.
All answers are in. The correct answer is it obstructs his view of Venus.
Woo-hoo.
And all four of you got that right. Well, we got blocking his view of Venus, enhancing Venus. So, you know what? We'll count all four of those as correct.
All right.
All got the gist. Okay, here, this isn't for a point, but just out of curiosity, does anyone here know the name of the weapon that Marvin the Martian wants to
use? Damn it. Go ahead, Griffin.
P-32 space explosive space modulator.
Q-36.
36. Okay.
Yeah. Close. Yeah. I was like, I think there's a number off there, but yeah, pretty much. Yeah.
I was going to shout out Ray Gun, but I guess that's
no. I actually thought it was 32. Also, I thought it was the P-32 explosive space modulator.
Moving on. Question number 5. In the first Tom and Jerry episode, Puss Gets the Boot, Tom was called a different name. What was he called?
I wasn't expecting Tom and Jerry. Tom and Jerry's MGM.
Technically, it's owned by Warner Brothers, isn't it? I thought yes. It was. Yeah.
It is now, but this is through like a purchase of a purchase of a purchase.
Yeah.
So, Griffin, you're not wrong. Yes, it started out as an MGM thing, but boy, you know how many times that company's been sold?
Answers are in. Jason, you got it right. The cat Tom's name in the very first cartoon was Jasper.
I was so close.
I just watched that the other day. That's why I know that. He was also called Jinx in a cartoon as well.
I also remember him being called Jackson, but that might have been because they were doing like a 50s zoot suit
no. thing. No, Mark, that was you watching Thriller.
No, technically, Mark's right. The episode where the zoot cat, yeah, he goes by the name Jackson, but I never really got that. I thought that was like a slang term maybe for someone who was really stylish back then.
And it may have been. I just, when you asked the question, it was all I could think of, and I knew I was wrong, but it was either that or put a stupid answer, and I'm like, let me at least take a shot in the dark here.
Yeah.
I just put a random name.
Steve the cat.
Ladies and gentlemen, I can tell you right now, we're going to go from bottom to top, and at the bottom, that would be Mark Radulich. One point. And then in third place right now sits Chris Radulich with 2 points. Griffin has 3, and Jason Teasley has only missed 1 point in this first round, and he is sitting at the top with 4 right now.
Question number 6. During the final season of the Flintstones, what was the name of the green alien that was added to the cast?
The Flintstones.
You know they did. They used to do cigarette commercials.
Gee, we ought to do something, Fred. Okay. How's about taking a nap? Hey, I got a better idea. Let's take a Winston break. That's it. Winston is the one filter cigarette that delivers flavor 20 times a pack. Winston's got that filter blend.
So all answers are in, gentlemen. The answer is the Great Gazoo. Great Gazoo, voiced by the late, the great Harvey Korman.
I remember he used to call Fred and Barney Dum-Dum.
Elementary, my dear Dum-Dum.
Make them read the part with more feeling.
That, Dum-Dum, is where I have to draw the line.
All right, and Mark and Griffin and Jason got the point.
What did you guess, Dad?
I went with Fred because what the hell?
Fred the alien? Okay, good.
Like it.
I can name the comic book character the Great Gazoo is based after.
Okay.
Mr. Spitlick.
Okay. I'm Superman.
That's right.
Yeah, very good. Question number 7. Which future member of the MCU voiced the title character in The Iron Giant?
Oh,
you want the actor's name, right?
Yes.
This is called a rock. Rock. Good. Yes. No. That is a tree.
All right. The answer is Vin Diesel.
I almost put Dom Toretto. Not gonna lie, because I could not think of Vin Diesel's name.
You should have just put family.
Iron Giant means family.
All right. Mark, Griffin, and Jason all got that right.
Yeah, Vin Diesel voiced the Iron Giant, and then he's Groot in the Guardians of the Galaxy movies.
Which both have the same amount of points.
Pretty much.
And maybe Guardians 3 will have the Fast and Furious crossover.
I hope.
Question number 8. This is a choice. Where do the Jetsons live? Is it A, Starlight City, B, Jupiterville, C, Orbit City, or D, Meteor Town?
Meet George Jetson. His boy Elroy. Daughter Judy. Jane, his wife.
The answer is C, Orbit City.
See, I actually got one of the choices this time instead of making up my own.
Griffin, Jason, and Chris all got that right.
Okay.
It seems like orc mischief to me.
Question number 9. In the Looney Tunes short, Mexican Borders, we see Speedy Gonzalez's cousin. What is the cousin's name?
Wait, Jose! Jose, I got to tell you something!
You will be good with the chili peppers.
Hey, Jose, something I forgot to tell. That's what I wanted to tell you. He packed a gun.
Is his sombrero too big?
Okay. The answer is Slowpoke Rodriguez. Okay.
Brother Michelle.
The hat I got for Christmas is too big. He's nice, but he's too big. Somewhere out there, a New York Times editorialist just had his nose twitch. Huh.
Okay. Griffin, Jason, and Mark, you all wrote that. Guys, I'm going to need to ask the peanut gallery here for Chris's answer because he just wrote slow.
No, don't give it to him.
I say give it to him.
First of all, I don't think anyone involved in this should have to should weigh in because everyone's got an agenda. I say we go to an outside jury. Lillian Jonas, come here.
Oh, wow. We all have an agenda.
Middle name?
The answer to the question was slowpoke. Grandpa just wrote slow. Do we give it to him, yes or no?
I would give it like half.
Okay, so Lily says no. No.
They both said
don't give it to him.
No, both said half, which equals one full one. So give me the point. I know how it feels.
Griffin, I'd like to apologize for involving you in this.
Well, I don't know. We could look at his poke as his middle name, so I would be the only one.
Good point.
Right.
His name is not Slowpoke Slow Rodriguez.
Slowpoke Rodriguez. Full name. I give it to him.
I'm saying I think half point.
All right. Done deal. It is in.
Half point is there.
Half point is there.
Whatever.
Take a breath, Mark. It's okay. It's just a game.
Mark sounds like me on the last show.
I don't believe in fractions.
You should have seen him back in high school.
We can't get away with my father not being on a podcast and not bringing up my elementary school math career.
Oh, wow.
Next question. It's a multiple choice one again, guys. What is the name of the security guard that is tasked with catching the Warners in Animaniacs? Is it Ray, George, Rufus, or Ralph?
We're doing this thing where we don't waste our first lines.
Make sure it's funny.
And something that really captures the intricacies of your character for old and new fans alike.
Perfect!
All answers are in. Gentlemen, you all got it right. It's Ralph.
One's across the board.
He even makes an appearance in some Tiny Toons.
Nice.
Loved his appearance because he was actually much more competent as a security guard in the Tiny Toon shorts. He actually got away with kicking out Buster Babs and Plucky on multiple occasions.
I think we both agreed that the short on the 2021 or 2020 Animaniacs of the security cam that's just watching him do things, what might have been one of the funniest ones of that entire season.
Yes, absolutely.
All right. Well, hey, we're at question 10, score break time, just to kind of update where everybody's sitting at. So after 10 questions, Chris is sitting back with 4.5. All right. Mark has a half a point more at 5. Griffin has 8. And Teasley went perfect that round to give him 5 + 4, total of 9. So he's in the lead with 9 points.
Woohoo!
Good job.
When I don't die, I do well.
Yes, sir.
Okay, number 11. This is a two-parter, gentlemen. You are going to have to name both, get both parts of these right for a full point. What is the name of Quick Draw McGraw's alter ego, and what is his weapon of choice?
Oh, I know this one.
Pick him up, train. Come on! Olay!
Stick him up, stagecoach.
Come on! Olay!
Stick him up, banker.
Come on!
All right. Quick Draw McGraw's alter ego is El Kabong. And his signature weapon is a six-string guitar. Griffin, Mark, and Jason, you all got that right.
Dad, you missed that one? You being such a fan of Huckleberry Hound and him coming from that same universe, I am shocked. Shocked, I tell you.
Shocked.
Shocked.
Yeah, my memory.
Does he get, so did anybody get, did Chris get like half a point or anything like that?
Oh my God, Jesse.
Oh man, no, I want him to beat you so bad.
I get them both right.
Sorry. All right, then. Sorry, but Chris wrote the Lone Stranger and the Six Gun.
Ooh, so close.
Yeah, that's sorry, right. Man. I'm afraid that neither of them were close enough to.
I have a funny feeling if he had written Huey Lewis and the News, you'd have been like, done. He gets it.
I kind of want to hear about the Lone Stranger. That sounds like a Radulich and Broadcasting Network short.
Please stop pitching ideas. I'm only in the marketing department now. I'm out of content creation.
And how come you keep flooding my chat with ideas for shows?
Shut up, Alexis.
Question number 12. In Jabberjaw, the main characters play in a band. I'm going to give you four options here. I want you to tell me which is the name of said band. Is it the Tridents, the Neptunes, the Five Fathoms, or the Jolly Rogers?
I'm wanting to say...
Jab, 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 yes. Jabba Jaws, Jabba Jaws. He's the greatest shark you ever saw.
Who's Jabba Jaws based off of?
That would be Curly from the Three Stooges.
That is correct. Good job.
Jab, 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 Jabba Jaws, Jabba Jaws.
Okay, before Mark can sing anymore and terrify any more listeners away, the answer is the Neptunes. Woo. Yep, Griffin, Jason, Mark, y'all got that right.
I feel Chris got it right. He just didn't type it correctly.
Shut up, Jason.
I'm afraid Chris typed in the Jolly Rogers.
Well, I knew sooner or later I was going to open the bottle of the pile, and I see I'm rapidly maintaining that.
Next question. This is question number 13. This actor voiced Elmer Fudd till his death in 1959, but was not credited on screen until the 1982 movie Bugs Bunny 1001 Rabbit Tales. What is the name of the actor?
When I'm winding up the ball, it's ecstasy. But it doesn't mean a thing when so terrifically I swing, because the widow ball just sits upon a tee. When the strokes that I have missed are six or seven, I would wonder why the fellas laughed at me.
The voice actor for Elmer Fudd was Arthur Q. Bryan.
That's a tough one, man.
Now, Arthur Q. Bryan was voiced Elmer Fudd from his creation, but due to a contract that Mel Blanc had basically promising him sole voice acting credit on all cartoons in lieu of getting more money, none of the other voice actors were credited for quite some time. Okay, we only got two more questions in the easy round. Question number 14. The very first episode of Animaniacs featured a fun Calypso song titled what? Was it A, Macadamia Nuts, B, The Monkey Song, C, Water Tower Tango, or D, We're the Warners?
For a nickel, I'll give you a clue.
That's it! Hey, what's with the point? That's easy, easy. You want to play the flute? Wait, I got your flute. Hey, here's your flute.
All right, all answers are in. Mark, you want to start singing the song?
I do. Don't know what to say, the monkeys won't do.
Don't know what to say, the monkeys won't do.
For a nickel, I'll give you a clue.
You actually, that was part of the song?
Yes.
Yeah, oh, wow. Okay.
Well.
Look.
Yeah, Mark, you and
Tell
Chase
me among
got
them.
Right.
I do it right after you start seeing it.
I'm hearing. Well,
Macadamia Nuts was a song featured on the Animaniacs, but it was a parody of the Macarena and came much later in the series. Tastes Question good. 15. This series, considered one of the first Scooby-Doo clones produced by Hanna-Barbera, ran for 16 episodes and was given a spinoff a year later where the characters were sent into outer space. What was the show?
Can I give a fun clue?
Yes.
The actor who plays Shaggy also plays a character in this show.
Well, let's face it, Hanna-Barbera paid for Casey Kasem's house for many years.
Yes.
They pretty much have the exact personalities.
Yeah, more or less.
The countdown will begin this Sunday afternoon at 1, right here on the radio station you grew up with, Music Radio 138. Oh, fuck. What the hell's going on here? Oh, geez, well, isn't it the last hour? We got another hour to do? Geez, I thought we were almost finished. Good golly, Miss Molly.
The answer is Josie and the Pussycats.
I got it. Woo!
Long tails and ears for hats. Mark and Griffin got that right.
Okay, I guess technically almost every single Scooby-Doo copy had Casey Kasem in it, so...
It's time for a score update. In last place right now, Chris Radulich has 4.5 points. Mark.
Every time you say half point, I die a little.
half point.
Love you, Jason.
Then Mark Radulich coming in at third place with a total of 9 points. So we have a tie for first place. Griffin and Teasley both have 12 points from what I can see here. Yes, calculating that up. Total of 12 points. So they are both tied and at the top of this thing. We're heading into round two where we're getting extra points this round. It's going to be two pointers, right, Alexis?
It is.
Before we get to round two, it's time to quickly tell you about Amazon Music. If you enjoy rocking out to some great tunes, head to getamazonmusic.com/W2M network. You can get a free 30-day trial where you can check out over 70 million songs. That's getamazonmusic.com/W2M network for that free 30-day trial. Now, let's get back to our game.
Okay, remember guys, the questions are going to get a little harder and they are worth 2 points each. In the show Tasmania, what animal acts as the family dog?
Welcome to a land that's way under, down under. The sky's always yellow in rain or shine.
Come to Tasmania, come to Tasmania.
Mom's alive, why are dads no bump on a log? Molly's all fired up, we'll take place with the dog.
Come to Tasmania, come to Tasmania.
Richard Stone, you were the king of the earworms, man. Gentlemen, in the show Tasmania, the animal that acts as the family dog is a turtle.
That was close.
Wolf, okay.
I mean, they both have four legs. They're both quadrupeds, Jason.
Shut up.
And for the record, Jason's the only one who got that right. It was fun because it was a turtle, but it acted like a dog.
Yeah.
So they called it the family dog. All right. Number 17. In 1943, Warner Brothers was tasked with creating a series of shorts for the United States Army, intending to instruct service personnel about various topics like security, proper sanitation habits, booby traps, and the like. The shorts featured a soldier who constantly did the wrong thing. What was the soldier's name?
I almost think I know this because I've heard you guys talk about it again. This is one of those ones.
This is another I wish those multiple choice moments.
Yeah, I was really hoping she was going to get multiple choice there.
I'll be the war's greatest hero. With these guns, I have nothing to fear, oh. My guns are the best. They can meet any test. Oh, I'll be the war's greatest hero.
The shorts featured a soldier who constantly did the wrong thing. His name was Private Snafu. Again, Teasley walked away with that one correct. Question 18. Dino, the beloved pet of the Flintstones, is what type of dinosaur?
A German Shepherd.
T,
Dino actually made was a icon for that Dinosaur Cats company for a little bit.
Did you know in the actually in the first episode where they introduced Dino, he talked?
I did not know that.
How are you? Glad to see you. Please go right ahead. Don't mind little old me. Grand, no, no, don't get up. I'll find my way out. Have fun. No.
Who the heck was that?
Yeah, I don't mind the idea of having him talk and then just deciding he'd rather be a pet, but it was so abrupt. He talks in one episode, and then every appearance after that, he just he yaps.
Huh.
All right. Teasley, you are on a roll, because the answer is a Snorkosaurus.
Call me butter, because I'm on a roll.
What did you put, Dad?
Brontosaurus.
That's what I put. I think we should all get credit for it.
Mark, and you would be wrong.
Was it like this with your teachers, Mark, where you like had to
know
every single question? You had to be like,
with the exception of the metric system, I had all the answers because I was a genius.
Okay. Yeah, I believe that.
That can't do math.
Not the metric system, no.
It's not like we have witnesses on this podcast to refute. What?
You just talked about the one time, Jesse. It was just the one time.
I played the fifth.
All right.
19. In the Tiny Toons feature, How I Spent My Summer Vacation, Plucky joins Hampton's family on a road trip to a theme park. What is the name of that park?
Oh, I'm going to go on every ride till I barf twice.
Now hold your horses, Plucky. We've got to capture this Kodak moment. Excuse me, young man. Would you mind getting a few pictures of the family?
The theme park that they go to is called Happy World Land.
Damn it, I was off by one word.
Mark put Wacky World Land. He got
no.
Two.
Wacky World Land's where they're wacky. Happy World Land, they're happy.
All right, totally listen. First of all, you don't get a vote. You're a contestant. Let's go to the let's go to the panel of judges. Jonas and Lily.
Yeah.
Your father, who showers you in gifts and love and movies and fun times, and you're going to take you on a two-week vacation to an indoor water park,
Yes. Gave
the answer Wacky World Land when it was really Happy World Land. Is this not close enough? Should I not get the point?
You should not get one the point.
Yeah.
There we go. You should not get the
point. All right.
So they have spoken.
My favorite child, Lily, what do you think? So I should get a half a point, right?
Yeah.
Okay, well, the only vote that matters is you, Lily, because you're beautiful and talented. Now go away.
No points.
Alexis, half a point, right?
Yes, you could give him a point. You got two out of the three words, right?
You were giving him one point?
We're giving him 1 point.
There it is. All right.
Question number 20. This is a multiple choice. Which of these four classic Looney Tunes shorts has not won Best Animated Short at the Oscars? Is it A, Birds Anonymous, B, 99 Bugs, C, What's Opera Doc, or D, For Sentimental Reasons? And I did pronounce it like sentimental for a reason. There is a hyphen in there.
Wabbit Wikes. Kill the wabbit, kill the wabbit, kill the wabbit.
Kill the wabbit.
This may shock you guys, but the Looney Tunes short that did not win Best Animated Short at the Oscars out of the group was What's Opera Doc?
Yeah, that's the only one I knew.
Are you the only one that got that one right?
Yeah, Griffin got that one right. Christopher and Jason both guessed For Sentimental Reasons. That was a Pepe Le Pew short, and that did win the Oscar.
And it got canceled earlier this year.
We are not digging into that again, okay? I finally got past that.
Score update. Here we go. All right. So after these first five of the second round, and we will do a total at the end, obviously, but Teasley has a total of 6. So he's in the lead. It looks like Griffin got 2 on that last question. And then Mark, coming in at third place right now, has 1 point. And Chris, unfortunately, has not had the opportunity to grab one point at all this round. So he is sitting at 0.
Question 21. Scooby-Doo was named after a quote-unquote nonsense lyric from which Frank Sinatra song? Was it A, Strangers in the Night? B, The Lady is a Tramp? C, I Won't Dance? Or D, My Funny Valentine? Okay, the correct answer is A, Strangers in the Night.
Scooby-dooby-doo.
Jason and Mark got that right.
Okay.
Yay.
You didn't get that one, Dad?
No.
Did you put Shoes?
No, I put I Won't Dance.
That's not Genesis.
Spirit of Frank Sinatra is unbelievably furious now that we went from talking about him to suddenly singing Phil Collins. Number 22. Okay. On the show, The Herculoids, the main characters fight with the help of five different creatures. To get the 2 points for this, I need you to name at least one of the five creatures.
With Xandor, their leader. And his wife, Tara, and son, Dorno. They team up to protect their planet from sinister invaders.
All right. The five creature characters of the Herculoids are Zok, a bat-winged laser dragon, Igu, a rock ape, Tundro, a 10-legged, four-horned rhinoceros triceratops hybrid, and the two protoplasmic creatures, Gloop and Gleep.
Oh, I knew nothing about this show, so I just put Greek mythology beasts.
All right.
You know what? I give you credit for taking a shot like that. That's first ideas. But Jason's the only one who actually named the characters. He wrote Gloop, Gleep, and I love that instead of Igu, you wrote Igloo. But I'm drunk. Was that just like the autocorrect?
Jason, I've seen your text.
No, I can't speak.
I've seen your text. You type the same way sober. It's actually it's starting to cause Ronnie Adams to have a tumor.
Question 23. The late June Foray first voiced this character in 1956 in a Bugs Bunny short, but had already played another character with the exact same name in the earlier Disney short, Trick or Treat. What is the character's name?
I know that she done a famous flying squirrel.
Rocky, of course.
Yes. Yes, but that's the only person that I know that would fit the character I gave you.
A thunder of jets in an open sky, a streak of gray and a cheerful...
A loop, a whirl, and a vertical climb, and once again, you'll know it's time for the adventures of... Rocky and Bullwinkle and friends.
Well, the answer is with Hazel. Jason, Griffin, and Mark, you all got that right. Question 24. Which spooky villain did Mystery Incorporated go up against in their very first episode of Scooby-Doo, Where Are You? Was it A, the Pterodactyl Ghost? B, the Minor 49er? C, the Ghost of Captain Cutler, or D, the Black Knight?
And geographical board! At this point, 28 and a half feet
up from sea level. Ooh,
that tickles. This is bad.
All right, all answers are in, and Griffin and Jason got it right. It is D, the Black Knight.
The armor was black because it came to life at night.
There we go.
There we go.
Answer.
Good answer. Good answer.
It's because it's a villain. Yeah. It's racially motivated.
Please, let's finish this round.
I'm woke.
Did you pre-edit, Jason?
Pre-edit? No, that never happened.
Let's go. I'm on a roll.
Question 25. In the 2020 Animaniacs reboot, many of the characters were not brought back, including Dr. Scratch and Sniff's booksome assistant, Hello Nurse. What in-story reason was given for her departure?
You would think we did a because we did a podcast test. I'd know that answer, but nope, haven't a clue.
Well, then you fail.
Oh, she's politically correct. She's
she'd never collect. She plays Chopin and she doesn't rehearse. And when she's walking by, I give a little sigh and shout, "Hello, nurse!" She gets her math equations right.
Okay, points are all in.
Alexis, I demand you read my answer in song.
No. You don't pay me enough to do it.
I'll do it. You want me to do it? Jesse, can I do it?
First of all, before you do it, I want to say, Chris, your answer is incorrect, but that, I think, is actually one of the most creative answers I've seen. I give you applause, but no points.
What did he write?
He wrote that she changed her name from hello to goodbye.
Yep.
Way to go, Dad, for being mildly amusing. All right, my answer, Griffin, if you'll allow me, please, sir.
Okay.
Chicken Boo, what's the matter with you? You don't act like the other chickens do, 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 do. You wear a disguise to look like human guys, but you're not a man, you're a Chicken Boo.
And you are correct.
I misunderstood the question.
No. Okay, there's an episode in the 2020 reboot where the Warners are confronted with a hunter who has supposedly killed off majority of the supporting cast, only for it to be revealed it's Chicken Boo in disguise trying to get rid of the competition.
Oh,
but
okay.
That is not what happened to Hello Nurse. In the show, it is confirmed she joined Doctors Without Borders.
I like my answer better. She got pregnant.
I like my answer. The chicken song.
This is the question from missing what you saw with my answer.
It's all good, but I'm sorry. No one got a point for that.
Rose across the board.
Can you prove that she did get pregnant?
Oh, my God, Jason.
Date. Just to kind of put things into perspective here, we're going from bottom to top in round two. All right. Chris is at the bottom with 0 points right now. Mark Radulich coming in third with 5. And it looks like Griffin has a total of 6. And Teasley may have ran away unless he really tanks it this last round. He's got a total of 14 in this second round.
Whoa.
So be ready, ladies and gentlemen.
Which Hanna-Barbera character is the sheriff of the town Hoop and Holler? Is it A, Ricochet Rabbit, B, Quick Draw McGraw, C, Droopalong Coyote, or D, Okey Wolf?
Could it be? Yes, it could! Let's get up and jump for joy! USA Cartoon Express is here, and oh boy, have we got a show for you! We're going to be checking into the Wonderland Zoo so we can visit with our zany bear friends, the Hair Bear Bunch! And then, on to more outrageous bear shenanigans with Yogi! He's got a part on a Hollywood lot! Whoa, excuse me, shall we do lunch?
All right, answers are in. Gentlemen, the sheriff of the town of Hoop and Holler is Bing, 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 Ricochet Rabbit. And, yep, Griffin's the only one who got that right.
All right.
Yay, Griffin.
I'm pretty sure Quick Draw McGraw really never had his own town.
You know what? Looks like no. He was seen as sheriff in a series of short films set in the Old West, but they never actually named the town he was sheriff in. Question 27. We're coming back to a little bit more of a modern era, boys. In Freakazoid, the main character gets his powers when a code is entered on his computer, activating a flaw in the Pinnacle chip. But in the episode, The Chip, who first enters the code?
Ooh, not multiple choice.
Sorry, nope.
I don't even know if he could do it. I know the show. It just,
Super Teen Extraordinaire, Freakazoid, Freakazoid.
I'm afraid no one got it right because the correct answer was the cat Mr. Chubbikins.
I can tell you I have watched 0 episodes of Freakazoid.
Well, you are missing out because it's awesome.
Yeah, I've heard a lot of good things about it. I've never seen it.
I've watched maybe 1 or 2 episodes.
I've got the whole series on DVD. I love it.
Yeah, do you know what a freakazoid is?
No, I never saw it. But I was close. I had his dog.
Yeah, he's the only one that actually wrote, like, at least a quadruped.
We're using that word. It hurts my head.
Hey, there's that word again.
Question 28. This is multiple choice. I'm going to give you guys four characters, and I want to tell you, want you to tell me which one did Chuck Jones not create. Was it Pepe Le Pew, Henry Hawk, Tweety Bird, or Wile E. Coyote?
Oh, it's that dog again. That dog, I say, that dog is lower than a snake full of buckshot. Well, I'll just have to pay a visit to that blubber-headed hound and gently break him in two with my good right arm.
The correct answer was Tweety Bird.
Really? Huh.
Fun little fact. Chuck Jones actually did originally create Henry Hawk, and he appeared in a couple of shorts, one of which he went after Daffy, who was impersonating a rooster to try to get a cash prize in the best national rooster competition. But yes, when Robert McKimson created Foghorn Leghorn, he asked Chuck Jones if he could use Henry Hawk. And as Chuck wasn't really doing anything with him, he gave him over. And so many people assume that Henry Hawk was a creation of Rob McKimson. He wasn't. But Tweety Bird was created originally by Bob Clampett and later used primarily by Friz Freleng.
Bob Clampett, famous brother of Jed.
That's right. Barely kept his family fed. What's the score, Alexis?
Griffin got that right.
Griffin.
And Jason. Okay, only two more questions and then finally we can end this. In 2017, DC published a series of comics in which their superheroes cross paths with Hanna-Barbera characters. Who did they pair with the Flash?
Hey, Hanna-Barbera characters. I almost put a Looney Tune.
It's one of, the, I think, the many comics that gave Ronnie an aneurysm.
Yeah.
Now, the only one I remember is Snagglepuss, and I can't remember, and that wasn't right.
The gay gothic writer Snagglepuss that we all love and enjoy, because that was fantastic, outstanding book.
Oh, absolutely.
Huckleberry Hound hung himself.
Okay.
All right. Answers are in. Griffin and Mark got this right. The Flash was paired with Speed Buggy.
That's me.
Last question. In the Looney Tunes short, What's Cooking Doc? Bugs thinks he's about to win an Oscar, but which golden age of Hollywood actor do they actually give it to?
Very happy to bring to you the name of the great actor to whom we feel this honor is due. And equally good in character role. Our own
James Cagney.
I was close. I put Humphrey Bogart, but that's only because I remember him from the Well, Baby, We'll Have to Have a Ham Sandwich cartoon.
Yeah, slick hair. Why did you hit me in the face with a coconut custard pie with whipped cream?
Now listen, Tubby. You got exactly 5 minutes to bring me a fried rabbit, see?
Believe it or not, Jason got that right.
Easily.
Believe it or not, I walk in on air.
Flying away on a wing and a prayer.
I trained him in how to sing.
Dad, should I break into a Vita again?
Please, God, no.
Let's break into the scores here. All right, now.
Have some questions I actually studied for that never showed up that I would like to ask.
Bonus!
What cartoon was Bugs Bunny's official appearance? First official appearance in.
Easy, A Wild Hare.
Goodbye, pal. Goodbye. Mr. Wabbit, say something. Speak to me. I killed him. I killed him. I'm a murderer. I'm a wabbit killer. Why did I do it?
Can't name the one before that?
Porky's Hare Hunt, was it not?
I'll talk. Honesty, I never done nothing to no one, but never done nothing to me. Don't go off, Hapcock. Put yourself in my place. I'm a married man with a family. Look.
Yes. Okay. Name the dog and the cute cat.
Mark Antony and Pussyfoot.
Name the book that the Abominable Snowman was based after.
Of Mice and Men.
Is it really?
Correct.
Yeah, he's based off Lenny.
I always wanted my own little bunny rabbit. I will name him George, and I will hug him and pet him and squeeze him.
I'm not a bunny rabbit.
Before we head into plugs, this would be a good time to tell you about a sponsor of the W2M Network, and that is Grammarly. For you, the listeners of Tripped Up Trivia, Grammarly is offering a free download of the Grammarly software. Grammarly's AI-powered products help people communicate more effectively. It also helps you write mistake-free on Gmail, Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, and nearly anywhere else you write on the web. Grammarly corrects hundreds of grammar, punctuation, and spelling mistakes, and while also catching contextual errors, improving your vocabulary, and suggesting style improvements. To download Grammarly today, go to getgrammarly.com/W2M Network. Again, that's getgrammarly.com/W2M Network to download Grammarly for free.
Character's name is Lenny. Let's go ahead and do plugs. Mark, you said you wanted to go first?
Yeah, just a couple of quick ones that I know are up as of today, July 17th, 2021. Last night was supposed to be the new 2021 Cinderella movie in time for release of that. We released our, unfortunately, that's not going to release now until September, but hey, the schedule changes for No Man. So we released our Damn You Hollywood review of the 2015 Cinderella that myself and Robert did. One of the very first Disney live action remakes. There was also, in theory, a triple feature from myself, Jason Teasley, where we reviewed America, the motion picture from Netflix, Team America World Police, and Nerdland, starring Patton Oswalt. Today, alongside of this release, this Tripped Up Trivia WB animation show, is also our Long Road to Ruin for the animated Cinderella films that Sean Comer and I did probably around 2015 when we reviewed the Cinderella movie. We looked at the animated feature and the two direct-to-DVD follow-ups. Tomorrow is our season two re-air of Voltron. And then this week, coming up on the Radulich Broadcasting Network, we've got reviews for Slammiversary and Money in the Bank. We'll have a Long Road to Ruin for the Netflix trilogy of Fear Street. We did this timely because myself and Alexis Haina will be reviewing Space Jam 2. It also should be in the archives now. It'll be this Thursday. Chris Bailey. Thursday will be the on trial for the original Space Jam. And Jesse, Wednesday, this coming week, July 21st, oh my gosh, we're going to save the rave, Jesse.
That's right.
God Save the Rave by happy hardcore band Scooter. We'll be on the Metal Hammer of Doom, so you can give that a listen. And then this coming week, G.I. Joe Snake Eyes is going to be in theaters. We've got a whole lot of G.I. Joe going on. First of all, Jesse's got a syndicated source material for G.I. Joe versus Transformers. And Jesse, do you remember back in the days when we were young, we're not kids anymore, where you, me, and a bunch of other nerds and my kids who were much younger back then did an alternative commentary for the G.I. Joe animated movie?
Yes, I do. Oh, boy, was that a lot of fun.
Yes, it was. Well, we're going to dig that one out of the archives and throw it up as you go see Snake Eyes in theaters. And then because God hates me and my schedule, we will also have a re-air of our Damn You Hollywood Hotel Transylvania 2 review, which was supposed to coincide with Hotel Transylvania 4. But hey, why leave movies in the place that we were going to release them when we can move them after Mark, you know, finalizes the schedule for the year? So it'll be there for people to listen to. Hotel Transylvania 2, Damn You Hollywood, for months from now when Hotel Transylvania 4 comes out. And you might be asking, did you review the first and the third one? No, because we hate odd numbers on the Radulich Broadcasting Network. Apparently. All right, I'm done now.
Very good, very good. Jason Teasley, I know you do things over there on the W2M, well, here on the W2M Network. What, plug some stuff, man.
Well, by the time people listen to this, my new podcast will be debuting, but it is not part of the W2M Network. You can find it on YouTube under the Second and Short banner, where I have taken on the role of a actual panelist on a fantasy football podcast, getting back to my roots, that where me and Jesse started from the cheap seats so long ago. Mm-hmm. Also, you can be looking for me and Eric Watkins and Kennedy to be popping up on the Black Irish. But also you can find me on as I also help anchor the kickoff, our weekly NFL podcast. And that's pretty much it. By the time it airs, I'm sure that Jesse will have me doing something to coincide with upcoming movies pertaining with my favorite comic book character. A lot of things, as Mark mentioned, me and him's got a triple play coming up that is going to be real fun because I'll probably be intoxicated for it as well. And that's about all I've got. All
right. Just to make sure, Chris, you didn't have anything you wanted to plug, right?
No. In fact, I'm going to drop off and head on home. So hey, you guys enjoyed it.
Thank you very much for coming, sir. We appreciate it. All right.
Bye.
Have a good one.
Bye.
All right. Okay. I'm going to go ahead and run down the scores. You ready, Alexis?
Go for it.
All right. Chris Radulich left the game with 4.5 points.
Nice. Well done.
In last place. Don't give him a hard time, Mark. You tell him thank you for being such a good sport. Okay. Give your dad a hug. Tell
him you love him. I may not roll my eyes at him as he leaves.
You tell him you love him and give him a hug.
Just hit me in the head. That's abuse, sir. Now everyone in the world heard it. All 20 of our listeners.
He's probably like, I can't believe you made me do this, son. Third place. Mark Radulich comes in at 16 total points. Griffin, you came in second with 24, 12 in each round. Fantastic job. And Jason Teasley runs the game with 30 points. Wow. Impressive showing, sir. I am absolutely flabbergasted. You were able to drink and get through this with winning and not dying.
Well, just a reminder that next month, August, as we mentioned prior, the theme is going to be toys. This is, of course, tying into several source materials that we're going to be doing, covering Transformers and G.I. Joe and such, and, of course, the release of the Snake Eyes origin movie. So we are going to be looking for contestants for that. Go ahead and hit us up on Facebook or Twitter if you know your toys and you want to play.
All right, it's time to call this a night. Congratulations, Jason Teasley, on winning July's rendition of Trip Tub Trivia. For Alexis Hanna, I am Jesse Starcher. There's Griffin, Mark, Jason. We're out of here. Have a good one. Bye-bye.
That's all, folks.